Grace to you and peace. Welcome to worship at Hickory Hills Presbyterian Church. This morning we are ordaining and installing elders and deacons. And so as a part of that, we are reminded of our baptism. And so I invite you, if you are at home, to find a dish or a cup and put some water in it so that you also can dip your fingers into the waters of baptism as we prepare for the ordination and installation. Also, as a heads up, we will have our new elders and deacons joining us here up front, and when it is time to lay hands on them, I will invite you, who are virtual, to also extend your hands to be a part of that service. A couple of other announcements and reminders. The first is that your annual reports, if you are head of a committee or ministry, are due today. And so if you have not yet gotten those in, we need them now. And the annual report will be published on the 24th in advance of our annual congregational meeting, which will be on the 31st. Details as to how that is going to go will be forthcoming. One more thing is that our Super Bowl Sunday is not going to be happening the way that it normally does this year. But rather than just not have Super Bowl Sunday on the 7th of February, we thought we would do something different. And so we are inviting you to bring in canned soup for our micro pantry and for Elsie's. We're going to challenge you to bring in either a field goal worth, so 3, or a touchdown worth, which would be 7. And then at the end of the service on the 7th, we will add up our score and publish it to you. And so that's how we're going to do our Super Bowl Sunday this year. Different, but still able to do some ministries together. And so, people of God, let us prepare our hearts for worship. All who thirst, come to the water and drink deeply of these living streams. Come, all who are weary, all who yearn for forgiveness. Our gracious God beckons us and blesses us. Let us give praise for new life in Christ. Let's pray together. Glory be to you, O God, who we worship in awe and wonder. You are the author of all beginnings and all that is pronounced good. In you, both day and night have purpose. Both calm and storm have meaning. Open the eyes of our imagination, that we might be ready to receive your gifts and discern your activity in our midst. In the name of Jesus, in whose baptism we too are baptized. Amen. I would invite you to join us in singing. The words will be on the screen, "Baptized in Water."
By the
People of God, come in repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. In baptism, we are washed clean, adopted into the family of God. As God's children, let us come and confess our sins, asking for and receiving forgiveness. Let us pray together. Merciful God, in baptism you grafted us into the body of Christ, promising us forgiveness of sin and newness of life. But we fail to live as a forgiven people. We keep destructive habits and hold grudges. We allow our past to hold us hostage and are reluctant to welcome newness. In your loving kindness, have mercy on us and free us from sin. Remind us of the promises you made to us in baptism, so that we might live as your people claimed in the waters of promise. Amen. People of God, hear these words of assurance, of forgiveness. Before you were formed, I knew you, says your God. I knit you together in your mother's womb. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. I have swept away your offenses like a cloud, your sins like the morning mist. You are mine.
Thank you. struck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Amen. Our first lesson this morning comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And then we're going to turn to the Gospel of Mark, reading again chapter 1. Beginning at verse 4, hear the word of God. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, and a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart, and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This morning, I want to play a word game with you. I want to invite you to relax a little bit. Close your eyes if you want. And when I say a word, I want you to allow an image to pop into your head. Think of it as a word association game. Words and images. Are you ready? Ice cream. Tacos. Salad. Pizza. Blueberries. Cake. What did you see? What did you smell? Are you hungry now? Are some of these words more pleasant to you than others? How about these words? Friend. Mother. Father. Sister. Brother. Caregiver. What did you see? What did you feel? It is possible that for some of you, some of these words are deeply painful. They might drag up memories of old wounds or trauma. For others of you, these words invoke love and connection and deep feelings. One more round of words. Jesus. Forgiveness. Justice. Cross. Resurrection. Shalom. What did you see? What did you feel? For some of you, some of these words have much deeper meaning than others. For some of you, some of these words might be ones that you're still trying to understand. Some of these words hit deeply. Some of them, maybe not as much. Some, maybe not at all. Our words are powerful things. Words create worlds. I want to take a deep breath and wonder about the power of words. Not just the words in our game, but the words in our world. In the beginning, the Spirit of God hovered over the chaos and darkness. As God moved in and amidst the darkness, God spoke and said, "Let there be." And it was. In the very act of speaking, God brings things into being. Let there be, and there is light. Let there be, and there is land, and there is water, there is day, there is night, there are creatures. Let there be. And God's words create. Words are powerful. And it's not just in creation, is it? It seems that whenever God shows up and speaks, things happen. God speaks to individuals throughout Scripture, and they are sent, and they are empowered. They are compelled to act, even sometimes despite their objections. God speaks, and things happen. As Jesus was lifted up out of the water of baptism, the heavens were opened, and what? God spoke. "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." I wonder, was this the first time Jesus heard the voice of God? Was it the first time he understood his mission and his ministry? Probably not, because he did come looking for John. And yet there is power in those words, isn't there? in the naming of Jesus, you are my son. You are beloved. And what else? With you I am well pleased. Before Jesus did anything, before he preached, before he taught, before he healed anyone, before Jesus did any of the things that we worship and revere him for, God named him beloved. And with you I am well pleased. God's words are creating, casting vision, preparing the way. God's words are naming what is and what will be all at the same time. When God spoke creation into being, when God spoke and breathed life into us, our breath was literally given us by God. Our words were given to us by God. Just as God's words have the power to create, so also our words are powerful. Our words have the ability to create worlds. No, not like God created worlds, but still our words have power. When we speak, we bring things into existence. Yes, our words need to be followed with action. We cannot just speak and say things out loud and hope that they happen. We need to step into them. But our words have real power. If we are honest, we already know that. We already know about the power of our words because we have all of us experienced words being wielded as weapons. We've all been wounded by something someone has said to us directly or about us. We have been wounded by words spoken in anger or frustration, or maybe even hate. This week we bore witness to the power of words, bringing people to madness and violence. We have all of us had our integrity or our identity called into question at some point or another. We've all had the experience of our words or someone else's words wounding us. The research tells us that when someone tells us or says something to us that is negative, it takes a minimum of 7 positive comments to counteract just 1 negative. I would argue that if it is someone who is in authority or someone who is important to us, it probably takes even more than 7 to erase 1 comment that tears down. Is it any wonder that our words have real power? That isn't to say that we don't need to hear negatives sometimes, but rather that there is such a thing as constructive criticism. There are opportunities to come beside someone to speak truth to them in kindness and gentleness and still say hard things without diminishing them, dismissing them, wounding them, or harming them. Our words have real power to create worlds. We know this if we look at children, because children don't have the ability to hide their emotions the way we have learned to hide ours. When a child hears something that hurts them, their faces show it immediately. But it's still true of adults, isn't it? We might hide it better, but when someone diminishes us or dismisses us, it hurts. Because our words have real power to heal and to destroy. Brothers and sisters, this means that we have real responsibility and real power as well. As followers of Jesus, our words matter. What we say and how we say it matters. The words we choose and the way we choose to use them matter. It's true in how we speak, absolutely, but it's also in what we post, in what we write, and in what we share. How we speak as God's children matters. We are followers of Jesus, and that means that everywhere we go, everywhere we show up bearing the image of Christ. Let me say that again. We are bearers of the Spirit of God in this world. There are people who do not know Jesus, whose only encounter with Christ is you, as someone who lives a life of faith. One of the ways we know this is the number of people we encounter who used to go to church. If you listen to their stories, many of them tell stories of deep pain or feeling not welcome, places where they were diminished or cut down or wounded by something someone in the church said to them. Sadly, us clergy are often the guiltiest of this. And I don't say that to shame you. I don't say it to point fingers or to blame anyone in particular. If you think I am talking to you specifically today, I would invite you to wonder what the Spirit is trying to say to you, because I promise you, I did not sit down this morning or earlier in the week and think about who is it that needs to hear these words. I did not go through my Rolodex of church membership and think about so-and-so needs to hear me say this. Rather, I need to hear me say this. And maybe you do as well. If you are feeling challenged or convicted by what I am saying today, I want to invite you to explore your words. What have you been saying to yourself or to other people? What have you been posting or sharing on social media? What have you been telling yourself or about someone else? What do you believe about being a disciple? Do your words reflect what you believe? I try to reflect regularly on what is coming out of my mouth and what is rolling around in my head and maybe not making it out of my mouth. One of the decisions I made years ago was to not have professional and personal accounts on Facebook. That if I could not say something in one place in my life, I probably ought not be saying it in others. I wanted to make sure that I was working to integrate myself, that my public self and my private self would be one and the same, that my friends and my family and my church and my colleagues would see me as one person, not as different. If I was going to criticize something, I needed to be able to have it be publicly known. If I was going to tell the truth about my life, it needed to be something that anyone could know. This is just one small example of what I'm talking about when I talk about the power of our words. I have several other ways in which I keep track of what's coming out of my mouth and whether or not it's appropriate, whether it reflects my faith or something else. What about you? How are you checking your words? Where should you be speaking up more? Where are you remaining silent when you should not? Where should you be saying less? Our words are powerful. We can wield them as weapons, and with them we can create new worlds. What we give our word to matters. The commitments we make, the things that we give our energy and our life to, matter. Saying out loud the promises that we make before God and one another remind us of who we are and whose we are, and our responsibility to live as followers of Jesus in every area of our lives, not just in one or two pockets. Today we're going to ordain and install new elders and new deacons. These leaders are asked to give their word to serving God and to serving the church. You also are going to be asked to renew the promises made in your baptism. I want to invite you to listen carefully to the words. Listen to the power of what it is that you have said yes to, what your identity is in Christ, who you say you are, and who God says that you are. I also want to acknowledge that when we ordain and install, when we give our word in our baptisms, we are giving our word to something that is bigger than we are. There are promises that we make that are beyond ourselves. There are ideals spoken here that we aspire to and work towards becoming. We give our word to something we cannot yet do, something we aspire to be, something we are becoming. In baptism and in ordination, we are joining our voices with God. And when we do that, we are speaking a world into being. Let us pray. Give us today, Lord, ears to hear your words. Give us today hearts and minds and tongues to speak your words and not our own. Convict us when we have been harsh or unfaithful. Call us back with your words. Give to us the words of healing, hope, love, joy, sacrifice, and new life. We pray this in the name of your beloved, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. This has been a year unlike any other. And I don't know if those who said yes to serving last year as elders and deacons, if they had known what they were getting into, what they would have said. But it is important to give thanks for the leaders who have served us over the past several years, even as we welcome in new elders and deacons. And so I want to particularly say thank you to Scott Zimmerman, who has completed his 2 years, two full terms, as elder, and now has earned a year of rest. And thank you to Evelyn Garlick, who has completed 2 full terms as deacon, and to Karen Hoffman, who has completed her term as deacon. They have given their word to serving as elders. And thank you to Darlene and to Tom and to Jenny and to Andrew, all of whom have agreed to serve 2 terms as elder and deacon. We are so thankful because it makes such a difference in this place that you offer your gifts for this church. And so as we move into ordination and installation of new leadership, we say thank you to you who have served. And now, hear the word of God. There are varieties of gifts, but it is the same Spirit who gives them. There are different ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. God works through each person in unique way, but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. To each is given a gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together, we are the body of Christ and individually members of it. We are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our calling, to be disciples and servants of our Lord. Within the community of the church, some are called to particular service as deacons and elders and as ministers of word and sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us, providing for ministries of care and compassion in the world, ordering the governance of the church, and preaching the word and administering the sacrament.
Representing the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of Hickory Hills Presbyterian Church now ordains Evelyn Garlick to the office of elder and installs her to active service on the Board of Elders. The session also installs the active service of those who have been previously ordained, Deacon Linda Lavaretto, Elders Karen Hoffman and Susan Frangella.
Ordination calls the whole church to renewed commitment and reminds us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ in the covenant of baptism. Let us therefore together reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. People of God, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from all the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? I do. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? I do. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? I will. With the whole church, let us now confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal, gracious God, we give you thanks. In countless ways, you have revealed yourself to us in ages past and have blessed us with signs of your grace. We praise you that through the waters of the sea, you led your people Israel out of bondage into freedom, into the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus, your Son, who was for us baptized in the waters of the Jordan and anointed as Christ by your Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you that in baptism you gave us your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with a variety of gifts that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. We rejoice that you claimed us in our baptism and that by your grace we are born anew. By your Holy Spirit, renew us that we may be empowered to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen. If you are at home, I want to invite you to dip your hand in the water and be reminded of the waters of cleansing, the waters of your baptism. Remember and be thankful. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will those who are to be ordained and installed please come forward? Brothers, no, sisters, all sisters today, do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him, Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church, as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture, and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Linda, you are our deacon who is being installed. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? The rest of you are being installed as elders. Will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in the governing bodies of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Congregation, I'm going to back up just a little bit. Do we, the members of Hickory Hills Presbyterian Church, accept Evelyn, Karen, Susan, and Linda as deacons and elders chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we agree to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? We do. Normally, I would invite all of you who have ever served as an elder or a deacon in the church to come and lay hands on these who are being installed and on Evelyn in particular, who is being ordained. Obviously, our circumstances are different, and so we are going to raise a hand. If you are a member of our church, if you are a believer in Christ, you are invited to be a part of this. If you would extend your hands as we pray together. Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you called forth leaders to serve and equip them with your gifts. Among your people Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors, teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. With Moses, the 70 elders bore the burdens of your people, ministering in the power of your Spirit. Alongside the apostles, the deacons cared for all in need and guarded the community's peace. In the church, deacons, elders, and pastors served together so that your whole people might be equipped for ministry and built up into the full unity of Christ. For your servants in every age, O God, and for the Church of Jesus Christ, we give you all praise and thanks. Pour out your Spirit on Linda that she may be a faithful deacon in the church. Give her openness to the Holy Spirit's leading that she may see and serve wherever is needed. Train her in the school of prayer that she may express the compassion of Christ for the poor and the friendless, the sick and the grieving and the troubled. Equip her with courage to bear the gospel into the halls of power and to communicate your presence and might among those who are powerless. In everything, give her the mind of Christ, who did not grasp at greatness but emptied himself to become a servant of your reign. Give her joy in her walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for her work of ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit on Evelyn, Karen, and Susan, that they may be your faithful elders in the church. Give them prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish them in the life of the Holy Spirit, that they may exercise the ministry of discipline with humility and compassion. Guide them in governance on this session and in every court of the church, that they may be servant leaders, following Christ, who came not to be served but to serve, and give his life to set others free. Give them the joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence in their ministry. Gracious God, through the waters of baptism, you have claimed us as your own and called us to share in Christ's ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us that we may discern the gifts you have given, calling them forth from one another, and together use these gifts for the good of all. In obedience to Christ and the unity of his Spirit, may we proclaim good news, make disciples, be light and leaven, share our bread, offer a cup of cold water, wash one another's feet, make us strong in Christ to live as your people, and show forth your saving love in this world. Amen. Sisters, You are now deacons and elders of the Church of Jesus Christ, and for this congregation, be faithful and true in your ministry, that your life might bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. Welcome, and you may be seated. I have just a couple of prayer requests that have been shared. The first is from our friend Katie. Katie Barnacle is battling COVID herself and is asking also for prayers for her husband Joe, who was taken by ambulance and has been in the hospital. He's taken two steps forward, one step back, but they are both fighting COVID right now and would ask for your prayers. I also ask your prayers for my neighbor Ken, who's been in the hospital the better part of a month and has also had some steps forward and took a major step back this week in his battle. And so prayers for those who are battling and enduring. People of God, let us pray together. Gracious, merciful God, who holds all of the world in your hands, we come to you today as your people. We come seeking the good news of your Son. We come seeking to be reminded of our identity in you. Lord God, this has been a difficult and painful week in this country. And we acknowledge that we are but one of many in this world that are enduring hardships and challenges, times of fear and division. And still we pray, Lord, for our country. We pray for leadership and wisdom. We pray for the future, that we might find ways to speak to one another, to bind up the brokenness and the wounds of this country, and to move forward into a future. We pray, Lord, for your broken world, for those who are in need across this world, for those who have been displaced, for those who are homeless, for those who struggle in the midst of famine and need. We pray in particular today for those who are sick, who are in need of healing. Regardless of the illness, Lord, we lift them to you. We pray in particular for Joe and Ken and Katie. But Lord, there are many, many others who sit heavy on our hearts. Lord God, as our country hit milestones in terms of sickness and death this week, we lift to you those who mourn, who mourn loss of life regardless of how those lives are lost, whether it is age or disease or violence or depression or simply slipping away. We ask that you would comfort all who mourn. Lord God, you gave us words to speak. You gave us ears to hear. And you sent us out, commanding us to love you with all we are and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And so we confess today that that is harder than it sounds. And we ask for your help. We ask for your help in speaking words that bring life and create. We ask wisdom in the ability to hear one another speak. As people share their hearts and their fears and their concerns, give us wisdom. Give us ears. Help us to know when to speak and when to stay silent. Gracious God, we lift all of this to you. We thank you for those who serve you. We thank you for those who bring ministry to fruition, who enable us as your people to do your work in this world. We thank you for the meals that were prepared this week. We thank you for the lives that are touched in the work that we do. We thank you for those who serve as elders and deacons and in the many other ministries of this church. We ask, Lord, that as we move into this new year, you might guide us and lead us to be your people planted here in Hickory Hills. We lift all of this to you, praying the words that you taught your disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. People of God, go in peace this day. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with each of you now and forever. Amen.